For many years, I was president of the New School for Social Research in New York, and we did a lot of entertaining. And I learned to judge the decibel count and to tell whether it was a good party or not. And I would say by the decibel count, this has been a very successful party. And I just a real continuation of great conversations that we began during the day. It's a pleasure now to introduce our dinner speaker, Doran Weber, Vice President and Program Director at the Alfred Sloan Foundation. And I've known him for a lot of years. How many Super Bowls have we seen together?
The Giants was.
Yeah, yeah. Hey, guys, we have common friends in Art Singer, and we've known each other for a long time. For 20 years, Doran has run Sloan's award-winning program on the public understanding of science, technology, and economics. The program uses diverse media, books, radio, television, theater, even opera, to bridge the two cultures of science and the humanities, and to educate and engage the public. And I think we're going to hear, I hope, some about that tonight. Doran also directs the Sloan Foundation's efforts to promote universal access to knowledge through digital information, and also leads an initiative on the International Science Engagement that brings together scientists and engineers in conflict regions to collaborate on research projects. And of particular interest to me, since I was chairman of Scholars at Risk, is his support for the Scholar Rescue Fund, which has saved endangered scientists in nations under siege, think Syria, Iran, Iraq, Libya, and bringing those scientists to safe places to continue their work. So I want to simply, as I turn the podium over, to thank Doran and Sloan and Elizabeth and Rita Allen and the Moore Foundation for really making this this project possible. So, Doran?
No, not too bad.
Hi, everybody. So the good news is they told me 15 minutes and there's a 4-minute video in the middle. So you'll get through. I may not get through, but so I'm going to just talk about, as Jonathan mentioned, I run several programs to talk about the public understanding, which is obviously relevant to what we're doing here today, and briefly just about the Sloan Foundation. Most of you probably know this. And essentially, the overarching idea is to bridge the two cultures, and if you notice that the two things we highlight to enhance people's lives is providing a better understanding of basically of modern life, because as you know, I think 100 years from now people will laugh that it took a foundation to get people to talk about science technology if there's something separate from the way we live. And the other is to humanize science, to convey some of the challenge rewards of the scientific knowledge enterprise, to say that science is, it's a job like any other, and the people that do it are human beings, mothers and fathers and sons and daughters, and to the broad public, believe it or not, that's progress, to be able to show that, because if you understand that it's just yet another human undertaking, you look at it differently. And what it doesn't say, interestingly, is the aim is not to get people to go into science and technology. Now, Sloan has programs to do that, especially for underrepresented minorities and women. But the goal here, so my interface is with the 95% of the public who are never going to be scientists, engineers, and mathematicians. So it's really, what are they thinking? We want to make them more comfortable with science. And so eventually, they will be less suspicious, less intimidated, less confused, less distrustful. Science will have more support. And also, they'll be more informed, and sometimes they'll ask good questions, tough questions, but there'll be a more conversant interchange between the two cultures. So the way I think of what I do, Comcast, Time Warner, Viacom, Sloan is a kind of multimedia. And the idea is to a synergistic approach to commission, develop, produce, and disseminate an array of culture-defining products. Jonathan mentioned books, radio, films, theater, television, new media, all that translate science and technology for the lay public. This is something I came up with, the pinball machine. The idea is, How do you start the conversation about science? How do you get the science technology ball into play? Once you get into the pinball machine, the different media can amplify it, right? So a book can be turned into a film, can be turned into a play. I'll give you one example, which I'll get the Hedy Lamarr story. You know, Hedy Lamarr's known as a beautiful actress, but she was a pioneer, technological pioneer, developed something called frequency hopping, which is the basis of your cell phone and Wi-Fi. An incredibly brilliant woman, not given that recognition. So it's an amazing story. I first developed it as a play in 2000. It was produced in New York 2008. Then we worked on a screenplay for many years, ran into a dead end. We commissioned a book by Richard Rhodes called Hedy's Folly. That book was published. That book was then optioned. Diane Kruger, who just won Best Actress at Cannes, is now making a mini-series about Hedy Lamarr. And we made a documentary with Susan Sarandon that just premiered at Tribeca. So this is the pinball machine effect. You get the ball into play. The challenge is, how do you start? Because how do you introduce the subject? And being a writer, I'm particularly partial to books. So Sloan, someone asked about books. We have a big book program. I've supported probably about 100 books. You'll hear of the one on the left, right? Hidden Figures came to me 2.5 years ago by an unknown author named Margot Lee Shetterly. It was an amazing story. She had a line in there that I could still repeat where she goes, when I grew up, most of you know, if you've seen the film, you're aware of Hidden Figures, right? It's become a huge success. And you know, I get a lot of manuscripts. This one says, well, she was growing up in Virginia. She was African-American. She had like 5 uncles. They were all scientists and engineers. She said, when I was growing up, I knew so many African-Americans who were scientists, engineers, mathematicians. I just thought that's what black folks did. So that's a story that America needed to hear, because that totally subverts the stereotype. And it turns out that that's a culture-defining, it's more than even a successful film, Oscar-nominated and all of that, and the book has sold hundreds of thousands. I think it's changing the way we wonder how many other hidden figures there are out there, because it turns out Margot's been compiling an archive. There's hundreds, if not thousands, of African-American women who played this incredible role in science, and we just never saw them. Other types of books, we do science in everyday life, True Genius, Richard Garwin, History of Science, Hedy's Folly, Women in Technology, Women in Science, The Brain Defense, Controversial Issues, Neuroscience in the Courtroom, The Age of We're Interested in Art and Science, that's Eric Kandel's book, Everybody Lies, a new book about big data, and Our Robots Ourselves. I mean, it's fairly self-explanatory. These are the various radio. We helped start Radio Lab. We support Planet Money, Science Friday, Sirius 360. Radio is a phenomenal, it reaches, so Radio Lab is 8 million listeners a month, about just under 2 million broadcasts, and the other 6 million podcast downloads. So that's, you're getting huge audiences, relatively low cost. And again, the pinball effect, right? Somebody hears somebody interviewed on Radio Lab and they decide to write a play about it. These are a couple of the things that we did. I would mention LA Theater Works. What we do is, so we have a theater program, and then we turn the plays into radio theater. So even a successful play off Broadway gets a few thousand people. You turn it into a radio play. You can get A-list actors. They'll all go for one day. We then record it. We put it on public radio. We reach hundreds of thousands of listeners. We're very big in China. We have millions of Chinese because they love science plays. So they're listening to these little dinky plays that we're giving grants to in New York. And then they go to schools and libraries, and they're evergreen, so they're always there. Our television, a big partner, American Experience, the idea is bring science technology as part of the nation's history, so mainstream it. This was Rachel Carson. It was the anniversary of Silent Spring, by the way, just the day that the EPA changed some of its, you know, her book led to the Kennedy created a commission, and then under Nixon it created the EPA. Africa's Great Civilizations, against with Henry Louis Gates. Cancer, the Emperor of All Maladies, that was Ken Burns based on the Mukherjee book. And of course, Bombshell, Hedy Lamarr story, which will be on American Masters next year. It's going to festivals now. The other, I think, of their note, I mentioned Nova Science Ambassadors of Brian Green. So Brian, before any of you heard of him, I knew Brian. He would send me tapes of himself. The idea was we helped develop, you know, we try to find ambassadors, people who would be really articulate spokesmen, because science needs people. Neil, of course, now everyone knows, but it took him, you know, we supported him over many years because we thought he was a great spokesperson. Jan 11 is going to be, some of you may know her, cosmologist at Columbia. She will host a new NOVA series on black holes. And believe it or not, and I know Paula spoke here last year, she'll be the first woman to ever host a NOVA, which is really kind of remarkable. When I heard that, I said, okay, we're going to just do it, you know, because it's like, it, you know, how do you explain that? I'm not sure. Well, that's another discussion. So, and on that list, there's some interesting things we did. I'll just mention Copenhagen. So Copenhagen was a successful play, ran in New York for 2 years, won the Tony. I gave a grant to turn it into a television show. In one broadcast on PBS, as many people saw it as in 2 years on Broadway. So you're reaching like 2 million people, and then it's rebroadcast, and you have it forever. So that's the advantage of, we love theater, but then we want to use a different media to amplify each other. Well, now the, let's see, I think I'm supposed to, this is, and now this introduction to our film program, it's a little, it is literally promotional, but my staff told me to show it to you. It's my excuse.
I do believe that in the innermost nature of science, there is an artistic core.
Everyone thinks Enigma is unbreakable.
Good. Let me try, and we'll know for sure, won't we?
Having a vision, seeing something at the horizon, and then testing it. In science and in art or in filmmaking, of course, you are looking beyond the horizons. And that's a last bastion of real adventure.
A lot of our efforts could be summarized as trying to bring the two cultures of science and humanities together to give people a keener appreciation for the increasingly scientific and technological environment in which we live, and also to convey some of the challenges and rewards of the scientific and technological enterprise and the lives of the men and women who are involved in it.
I had the feeling that I had known you, like we are connected from past lives.
I don't believe in that.
What do you believe in?
I'm a scientist, I believe in proof.
There's very little attempt to communicate science successfully to the public. But the Sloan Foundation has undertaken to do it on a very broad scale.
People treat it like an unusual, quirky thing to do. Like, how strange to have a movie that has real science in it. But it shouldn't be any stranger than a movie that is based on a true story.
I'm grateful for the existence of the Sloan Foundation. Like, if this is the tide of culture, they're raising the tide.
Film Independent is very excited to be producing the 2014 Sloan Film Summit. It's going to be about 150 filmmakers and scientists for a conference to meet and greet and talk about work.
The summit is really a celebration of incredibly gifted filmmakers whose work we think the world should know about.
Doran is passionately committed to filmmakers and independent film and has really been a fantastic partner to Film Independent.
We have a great range of filmmakers at every stage in their career, and we help everybody, and it's the quality of the work that counts.
The Sloan Foundation was just so instrumental in being able to make a first feature film.
They were the first people who said, we believe in you and we think that you could benefit from meeting other writers and filmmakers and scientists.
Just knowing that a foundation of such stature believed in your movie, then it was like, okay, we're gonna pull through.
It's difficult for first-time filmmakers to find support financially or mentorship or otherwise.
They understand that to have a rich culture, you need to have a public who's engaged with science and a public who's engaged with the arts, and that's a very pure pursuit.
Film is important. It's a way to express parts of the human spirit and parts of the human experience. So it brings together every 3 years in a very unique couple of days, a chance for people from different worlds to kind of come and celebrate each other.
This connection between science and art has always been there. It's inherently the same thing, the same flame within, the flame of discovery, the flame of trying to articulate who are we? Who are we and where are we standing?
I'm just a mathematician.
Sometimes it is the people who no one imagines anything of. Do the things that no one can imagine.
So these are some of the films that we helped develop. And for the purists among you, for example, The Imitation Game, there were some critics that it wasn't purely accurate. They took certain liberties. But for those who are interested, there's a wonderful book, a biography, Enigma, and what happens is, you have to think of the accretive value of different, it's like an appetizer, with a beautiful mind. Same arguments were made about John Nash, but then a million people went on and read Sylvia Nasar's biography, which is much more accurate. So the thing is to get people interested, curious about a subject, and then hopefully they go and pursue it further on their own. There are a couple of other, the Ramanujan film, we're very proud of. That took, again, many, many years. Here are some films that we also give awards. So we both develop, we have a pipeline, we develop our own films, and then we recognize films that come out that we've had that represent some of the values that we want to support. And here's, so I have a kind of pipeline approach to the film program. We support six film schools. We give them annual awards in screenwriting and film production. We have science advisors for all of these things. So we have scientists sitting on all the committees, and the scientists can't pick the winning film, but they can exclude something because the science isn't accurate, and they can tell, and the screenwriters have to have a science advisor that helps them with the script, and then we have scientists judging the scientific merit of the project. So we work with the six film schools, and by the way, I read every single script from every single one of these. Sundance, Tribeca, Film Independence, San Francisco Film Society, The Blacklist. Then we're also interested in distribution because it's not enough to just get the film made. You've got to get it out there. We have a great partnership with Coolidge Corner Theater, Science on Screen. We're in about 60 different theaters all across America. And you mentioned the Science Entertainment Exchange. We're founding supporters of Science Entertainment Exchange, the National Academy of Sciences. They did it. Ralph Cicerone gets all the credit. He was the first one to actually get it right. Instead of talking down to Hollywood, he saw his role as just helping them, even with films that I couldn't support. I once said to him, Ralph, how can you give these science fiction? Because I've got to be really strict. It's got to be science, no science fiction. He goes, because I'm one tough son of a gun. Anyway, he did a great thing. He did a great thing, and they are embedded, and also it saves me a lot of problems. People ask me for advisors. I say, go to the Science Entertainment Exchange. They'll give you the advisors. These are some of our finished films, and these are ones in the pipeline, some of which I hope you'll hear about in the next year or two coming out. A theater program, again, equally active. In some ways, we've had more success with theater because it's written word matters. A little money goes a long way. $20,000 commission in theater is the big commission. Photograph 51, that's Nicole Kidman. She was the West End. That's a story about Rosalind Franklin and the discovery of the double helical structure of DNA. I took Jim Watson to the opening, so he sat next to me, so in case he threw a fit, I would be there to defend him. And I told him the secret was to make the actor playing him good looking. Don't worry about the science. They did that. Jim liked he didn't complain. And so we, just so you know the secrets to, anyway, Proof, of course, many years ago. We have two anchor partners, Ensemble Studio, and you look at the number, over 2,000 submissions, 300 commissions. 275 Productions, New York, 30 regional theaters. We have a new partnership with the National Theater. We have a play opening this summer, Mosquitoes, about Large Hadron Collider, a woman who works there. And it's yet, and the other important thing about theater, again, all the arts connect. So the biggest showrunners in TV, two of them, Bo Willimon, House of Cards, is a playwright we supported, Sarah Treem, who wrote The Affair. So they go back and forth. So if we expose them to science and they get science advisors, we're investing in them, just like we're investing in these film students early in their careers. New media, it's a kind of grab bag of different approaches, including the World Science Festival, which is going on right now in New York, which is why I have to run back. It's its 10th anniversary. There's the Science Festival Alliance, where's John Durant, who's has done a great job on creating like festivals all across the country. Beautiful Brain, Ramon Cajal, it's a book, an exhibition, father of modern neuroscience, an incredible figure. Virtual Chemistry Set, Listening to the Universe was our first foray into VR. It was on LIGO. We work with Chris Milk and Aaron Koblin. The idea is not just to, it actually has gotten over a million hits of views, but we're also, we go both down market to the public, but we're also trying to influence the creators of this. So in VR, there's just a handful of top people for the moment. We're trying to teach them how you do science. Science is much harder than other subjects. So we gave him an extra $100,000. He said it took them more time and more money than the five other. It was part of a first documentary VR series because they had to get it right. They worked. Jan Levin was their advisor. And it's a beautiful 5-minute virtual reality about the discovery of gravitational waves. And we also do opera, someone mentioned. And we're looking into gaming. We're platform agnostic. The idea is just science, get it into play, into the culture, high quality, accurate, scientific and technological content that goes into culture, popular culture, so it reaches a broad audience, it becomes more mainstream. That's pretty much the what does success look like? Two cultures become one, and you see the world like Leonardo da Vinci. Thank you. Thank you.
I'm going to read and take a couple questions.
Sure. I did. Yeah.
So we created a Boston Arts Academy. We worked with students on a game about the microbiome, human microbiome. We were told by the funder that we couldn't do games. So we had to call it something else, but it's basically a computer game.
I think that's a great thing to do. You know,
there's a lot of funding that has a perception of things like gaming and entertainment that isn't rigorous, or it isn't something that, even though the students are engaged, people are engaged in the process. I think it was a missed opportunity for the foundation, but I found that happens a few times. A few other examples that are not anything we worked on that have been for different reasons, whether it's the National Endowment for the Arts and games, through media arts, but this over the years has been sort of discouragement from going in that direction for teachers and for young people.
Well, to be fair, I'm testing the waters very gingerly myself, because the question is, can we, you know, we're not just interested, it's got a really advanced scientific understanding in some way. So just like with the VR, I wasn't sure, but they actually did a good job. So we're gonna explore. We have NYU, they have a gaming center, and they're sending us proposals. We did one game on Mendel, because genetics, that's at least something where you can actually learn something. The notion is the games, the audience is there, I agree with you. It's an opportunity. The question is how exactly to avail oneself of it, but I'm hoping we'll be able to continue in that area, but for the moment I'm testing it carefully, because I'm answerable to my own team of advisors. Yeah.
Is your stuff getting into the schools, and if so, how?
You know, that's not our first order, like in terms of, you know, it's the popular culture, but well, the World Science Festival, of course, invites students from all out of boroughs. The radio stuff, Radio Lab is actually unbelievably popular. Science Friday, students listen to that. In terms of the theater series, Relativity series, it's up to 22 science plays. That goes to schools, about 3,000 schools. You know, when we support NOVA, you know, like the JANA, NOVA has, of course, you know, connections to a lot of schools, but I haven't targeted. We actually, the short answer to people comes is we're not in the K-12. We don't do K-12. So it allows me to turn down a gazillion. Not that it's hugely important, I don't have to tell you. Yeah.
I wonder if there isn't a way to take everything you've got and to create one clearinghouse that would go, just be available in schools. So you're not becoming a funder of new stuff. You're just finding ways to purpose it into the curriculum at age appropriate levels in order to teach key concepts.
I think it's a great idea. So our biggest, the Museum Moving Image has a Sloan Science and Film. It's the go-to site. It lists over 500 projects, and and they did do a curriculum based on age appropriate, and people are starting to, it's an incredible rich resource. We've been doing this for years. The documentaries alone from the American Experience, and a lot of, you know, engineering stuff does really well, by the way, not just profiles. People love, you know, building of the bridges, the Golden Gate Bridge, whatever, you know, there's real interest. And, you know, the numbers are, I look at numbers very carefully. So PBS, despite what most of you think, does better than almost every, they do better than HBO and better than Showtime, and better, except for the rare breakout hit, but the average audience on PBS is still a couple of million. Nova goes up to 5 million. They do play with, you know, they claim 2.8 people watch. In most homes, you know, people are watching independently. So I think the numbers are all inflated, but they're all inflated the same way. So relatively, you know, they're still doing better than anyone else, but they may not be as high. But several million people are watching, and those are real numbers to us. I mean, we care about, as shallow as that, we care about how many people we're reaching, matters to us, yeah.
That was kind of my question is what are your metrics to know where you're putting your money and if you're getting a good return on it? I mean, other than just viewership, are you looking at whether or not the content has an impact?
Well, that was the question we couldn't answer. You know, I mean, that's a legitimate question. I don't believe, where's John Falk? Thank God for you. I mean, I agree with you. I think it's a tough question to answer, and I think that I don't have a quick answer for it, but I think learning takes place in many different ways, and this is contributing, and the question is at how much exactly, I don't know, but I'll give you like anecdotal examples, but to me they're powerful anecdotes. Well, you all know about the CSI effect, right? And you know, when that show became a hit, and many people called me up to congratulate me, I had nothing to do with that show, but I did go out to Hollywood, and I created a development office, and I worked with some of the leading writers David Milch and Stephen Bochco at the time. We had the hit show, so all the writers wanted to submit scripts because they wanted to work with them. So we showed that science could be sexy, or you could make money, or you know. And so CSI, and before that, the shows were ER and LA Law. So when those shows were hot, the number of applicants to Harvard, the top schools, everyone is part of the culture. And you think, oh, who cares about those hot young doctors, like, and who's sleeping through? You know what? Everyone cares, and it actually helps make those professions more appealing. Night at the Museum, right, that kind of Robin Williams film, the Museum of Natural History attendance went up by over 1 million, and it stayed. It's never come down since that. So, you know, you think, okay, dumb movie, but everybody's just, like, discovered the
museum.
Right. So the culture, or, and how many, you know, how many scientists I've met who told me 2001 A Space Odyssey, they went into science because of that, or women scientists who've told me Alien, because seeing a woman kicking ass, Sigourney Weaver, right?
Yeah.
Contact was another perfect example. So we know the culture, you know, again, exactly how to quantify it is the $1 million. I would love for, you know, people have great proposals about how to track it. I'm interested in it. When I first started, I did a search, and basically this is what I discovered with any advertise in television, even where they spend billions of dollars, the best studies would show that 1/3 of the time it gets you to buy something, 1/3 time it has no effect, and 1/3 it has a negative effect. In other words, it's very hard to prove, and that's advertising. Now, it's probably things have improved now with the internet and Google, you know, you can probably get some good, and I was gonna talk to Nate Silver, actually, people like that, about helping us, because I think we need the kind of newer way of analyzing, but we don't have, you know, I just go with that view of it's knowledge and learning is cumulative, and I think this contributes. I mean, we still want to have great, you know, colleges and universities and postdocs and train people, but we're also talking about reaching that 95% of the public who are not going that route, so this is one way that we think we're reaching them.
Let's take one more question here.
Sure.
So, Dara, what's on your horizon for Sloan in this area right now? What's on the horizon?
Well, we have a pipeline of, you know, more. I mean, I think for me, VR game, exploring new, constantly moving where the audience is moving, because we'll just follow the, we don't, you know, and try to bring science more into play. I think in terms of the public understanding program, I think that would be the, I'm going to try to give the books also a bigger platform. I think the right, you know, the average book today spells 5,000-10,000 copies, and all our books are on important subjects. Many of them are not; they're not going to be Hidden Figures, and we don't care. We want to support writers doing serious books about science. But I think giving them, let's say, a television platform, you know, and why getting the audience a bigger audience for them. I think for serious, I think people are getting a little tired of all that noise and yelling. So I think sort of the quieter, more thought. I think there'll be, you know, things will cycle back. So we're playing the long game. So we're going to try to find outlets for those kinds of things. But yeah, that's it. Okay, thanks.